Good afternoon, everybody. I'm going to go at a pretty rapid pace here. As you can see, my session is called Updates in Rodents and Rodent IPM. And I think everybody can appreciate...
Is that too dark?
No, that'd be fine. That'd be perfect. Your eyes are just in a second here. But, you know, pest management is a deep science. I think everybody knows that. Any aspect of pest management is a deep science, whether it be flies or cockroaches, bed bugs, rodents, of course. I'm in my 35th year of my career in pest management. It's been my entire life. I stumbled into it by mistake. I actually thought I was going to be an oceanographer. And I went to a community college, and I had a substitute professor who came in, off the cuff, gave a lecture on pest control, just to cover for the prof that didn't show up. I got up, walked out of the room, and I went right to the registrar. I changed my options from oceanography to pest control. I remember going home, telling my parents, I'm changing from oceanography to pest control. And they looked at one another like, okay, why would you do that? You know, it was like pest control of all things. And so I've never looked back. I think many of us in this room can appreciate it. It's almost like the coolest secret, right, if you're involved in pest management. All the things we do, protect food, protect health, protect safety, comfort, you know, people's general well-being, all that's done within pest management. And, of course, in rodents, within this area itself, being mammals, as I'm going to talk about, these are amazing animals, and I've spent most of my years since graduate school branching out into rodents. I do want to say, you know, it's really an honor, you know, to associate with the program, and it's an honor just to work with the armed forces, of course. All right, so this, thank you so much, you know, Captain Cope, and back to Harold Holland, actually, also, you know, goes back with me in terms of the pest management industry, and working together with issues over the past. So thanks for the invitation to be here. It truly is an honor. This is not about basics, and certainly we're not going to talk about basics. I just wanted to cue up the fact that, you know, when we talk about rodents, rodent IPM, we're talking about the big three. That's the house mouse, the noy rat, and the roof rat, of which some of you in this room, you're in roof rat country, and that's your primary rat. Others here have no roof rats whatsoever. Right? But I think it's worth mentioning, we're actually looking at, right here, this is the second most successful mammal on Earth, the house mouse. We claim to be number one as a mammal. This is the second most successful mammal on Earth by all measurements. This, perhaps, we estimate is the number third, and rats in general come in as a successful group. So everyone knows those names, the house mouse, noy rat, and the roof rat. You know, we know this animal backwards and forwards in many ways. Certainly as a laboratory animal, we know more about this animal than any other animal. But in the field, in terms of, say, a mouse just in a commissary, for example, we have very little research to understand home ranges, feeding behaviors, reproduction, nooks and crannies, nesting criteria, all the population dynamics of these animals in and around wild areas inside buildings, even though it's common. In fact, the moment that 100% unison, everyone in this room, someplace, you've had direct association with this mouse in your own lives, regardless of your responsibilities, either growing up in your homes, or in college, or in a dormitory, or in an apartment right now, or in a house, so forth. We associate with this animal, the house mouse, more than any other mammal on the planet, the house mouse. Right? Much more than dogs, much more than cats. We just don't do it directly. Right? So, number two there, an unbelievably gorgeous animal by any stretch. To me, that is so beautiful, that animal to look at. So, you know, a lot of days I walk the streets in New York, as you'll see, and I see rats, I see mice, and I'm always paying my respects to them. You know, as we'll talk about, for example, just right here, they can do things with these. These are called vibrissae. These are not just hairs or whiskers. These are nerve organs. And so they can do things with these vibrissae in different parts of the body that humans cannot equate to, we can't equalize, we can't do with our touch, our vision. These animals are very, very sophisticated in what they can and cannot do, right? And it's an incredible beast. We all know this, it's a gnawing mammal. That's what rodent means. Animals that gnaw. I'm going to come back to this a little bit later because this in itself impacts a lot of what the armed forces will do and why we need to do it. A mouse on a plane, for example, is a serious business. And I fly a lot, of course, usually, sometimes a month I'm on planes. I'm always staring at the ceilings. I'm always worried whether there's mice up there. Because they gnaw on wires. They have a propensity for going for wires because they look like plant stems. Right? And I won't share your horror stories, but I've worked with the airline industry. I've taken personally dozens of mice off planes that are in business, scheduled to fly. Right? And so that, and looked at the annoying damage. So we have to be constantly aware of the threat by the particular animals in that regard. There's the business end of the skull of a rodent. Again, I'm going to come back to this. I start out this way. But one of the primary characteristics, not the only, is this prominent space between the incisors and the molars. That's called the diastema, right here, the space. The rodents take their cheek fur, they plug it into that space, so when they gnaw on plastics and wood and wire or anything, they don't ingest those items. All right, so they have this plug. And this is why when people say, why don't we just come up with a repellent that is so foul-tasting to the rodents, they won't gnaw on wires and plugs and damage walls. And, well, they don't even use the tongue. The tongue is back here behind the plug. The business end, when they're gnawing on things we're trying to protect, is just teeth. So this whole business to come up with a bad repellent that tastes bad is flawed in concept alone, right? And so right there, but we're looking at a rodent skull. Well, here it was for me, back when I thought it was going to be an old shark fur, and then I thought, well, pest control. And I just serendipitously came across this quote by James Clavell back in the 70s when I saw that. It was like, well, whales are cool, but what about the rat? Right? And ever since then, when I look back with this particular animal, I constantly relive these words. The picture I'm about to show or share with you, I work for an advisor to New York City as a consultant and part-time specialist for them. I'm out in New York City streets on a regular basis. And of course, I'm out at night, because that's when the action is. And so, as no surprise, we have this animal. When I took this picture, it's pitch black in a room. Of course, garbage and rats. This animal needs, just like you and I, we're having lunch right now, just finished lunch. It needs to eat, right? And the average Noi rat, for example, goes from anywhere from an ounce to 3 ounces of food every 24 hours, depending on its reproductive condition and stature and dominance of organs and so forth. But you can see we have a healthy male here. Very important, it's a 1-to-1 sex ratio with the rodents. You actually can use that in trapping programs. If you count the boys and the girls, on the number of animals you capture on a clean out, you can estimate your progress rate and your success rate just by knowing sex ratios. So there it is. It's beautiful. It's good. You'll see those vibrissae, very prominent, very prominent. This animal's doing things with those vibrissae and the sense of smell that research has shown is just incredible. All right, and I'll come back to that a little bit later. This quote, 1912, out of a history of British mammals, and for, I think the Brits, just for what I feel, have done the best rodent research ever on the planet. The best early research came out of Oxford, and to this day, the Brits contribute with the best rodent research going on. A lot of it comes out of England. But in 1912, they said, diabolically clever. They're diabolically clever. And when I first read this in grad school, I was like, you know, that's an old world, a little bit of an overkill. But now, when I watch them in the streets of New York City, and I go into buildings with them, and I sit back and I just share my space with them, I'm always saying, that's amazing that they can do this. In fact, when I started out in graduate school at Purdue University, this is a barn I used to hang out in, literally. I just spent my entire weekend there. I live with the rats. I would sleep when they slept. I'd be up when they up. I'd just stay with them. I'd lay on the floor with them, take notes, take pictures, and so forth. And back in grad school, I used to, this is the pictures, about 2 a.m. in the morning, I'm standing with the rat trap, but I watch a rat constantly jump over back and forth and come back and jump over it again, and then come back. And pretty soon, just, I have to assume by luck, the tail set the trap off. I went over, picked up the trap. I was looking back thinking, holy cow. You know, these are amazing animals. You know, but they're very, very clever. We have to be careful, though, of giving them too much credit and saying, you know, they're really smart, figure out all kinds of plans. But that animal in my barns is always something I admire. By the way, you'll see the droppings around this rodent. The whole area of rodent pheromones is a frontier waiting. But we do know this through refereed published papers and in good journals, that those droppings do contain pheromones that tell other rats to eat in an area if it was successful for them. So that was published by some Russian scientists, showing that there's feeding pheromones within the droppings. which I use all the time when I'm putting out new rat traps, and it's not a food contamination issue. I will collect local droppings and put those all around my rat traps to jumpstart those traps and bait station. So we are getting there. We have this diabolically clever. Sometimes we put out a bait box like this containing bait, and especially in New York, I come back to check my bait boxes. Amazingly, they will have the audacity to move into my bait box and make a bedroom out of it. You can see, and the rats did this. The rat actually wove paper towels over all the cold pieces of metal. Look at that. There was a piece of metal right here. They didn't like that. They said, no, it's too cold. I don't want that. So they tried to cover up all the cold spots. Cold is a threat to small mammals, lose body heat readily, you know, large surface volume, low biomass, they lose body heat. So that's one of my bait stations, like here, Bobby, here's where we think your rodent IPM program. And so they went in and covered everything up. In the floors, this is all rat damage. And I actually, it was pitch black when I took this picture inside this building, and they gnawed a hole down into the subflooring. When I took my camera down there, and I took a mirror and stuff, beady eyes everywhere down below, waiting to come out if I would just get out of the way. But at least I captured that guy looking up in my direction as to, you know, when's this guy going to disappear, right? Here, I put this in because there's a lot of myth about rodents and sizes and all kinds of things. But this is, in New York City, I took this picture, pitch black. Just every once in a while you hear about super rats and big rats. This is a pretty big rat here, pretty big male. You notice it's got scar tissue on the back where he gets in fights a lot. It looks like his tail's been in a fight or a trap. For perspective, there's an LP base station right back over here. So you can see the size. When people see these large, dominant males, they'll say, you know, I saw a rat that was as big as an alley cat, you know, kind of thing. But they don't get as big as alley cats, but they certainly do get, in some cases, upwards close to 2 pounds, right? But if anyone ever brings me a Renoi rat that exceeds 2 pounds, you know, I'll stuff it. I'll put your name on it. It'll go in a plaque. I just don't believe it. We've never gotten it yet. There was one rat captured out of Iraq, of all places, in Baghdad, 1 pound, 7 ounces. And that's one of the highest, heaviest rats of all time, 1 pound, 7 ounces. Right? So, but that guy, when I saw him, I was like, yeah, that's a good-looking rat. I do a lot of work in these environments. Right? And I go out at night. That's where the whole area below this cobblestone. This is early New York, original cobblestone. This alley's still there, just like this. Rats love alleys for a lot of obvious reasons, including being secretive and staying out of trouble, what have you. People drop garbage here and what have you. But alleys and rodents. And so I'll go out my video cam. These bags behind me, a newspaper reporter was with me and took this picture. But these bags behind me were all moving, like beating hearts. Just like boom, boom, boom. Because the rats are inside feeding, jockeying for position, trying to grab some things. Even though it's supposed to be all recyclable here, a lot of people throw food in there anyway, and the rats get in. I like when the bag's translucent because I can just go right up to the bag, look in, and see boy, girl, adult, juvenile, so forth. Makes it easy. Here, and again, New York, by the way, New York is the retropolis, number one retropolis in the world. We own that title. We're proud of it. It's number one. There's a lot of reasons for that. But on this particular night, I was, you know, on my way to have dinner with friends, actually, at a casual restaurant. I'm waiting at a light in Midtown. This is Midtown Manhattan. I was just standing there. I almost didn't want to think about work. I'm waiting for the light. It comes right out of the sewer. Stands next to me like, hey, Bobby, what's happening? And I was like, I'm off. You know, leave me alone kind of thing. But there he goes. He heads down. Now, by any stretch, really, look, this tail is straight up off the ground. Gorgeous form. If we were doing Olympic scoring, he might hold up a card. 9-2 or something. But that's beautiful form. Just gorgeous. Right? He's heading off, avoiding the puddle to some degree. There was where he marked from. But at first, I'm like, well, I'll take this picture. We'll go from there. You see him? Now, the fact that rats and mice, by the way, are colors that camouflage, like the Noi rat has the color of dirt, earth. That's, of course, not to be seen. A house mouse is this gray, shadowy color, like the color of the shadows behind your stove or something. Not a mistake. These animals camouflage to avoid detection right there. So this animal's heading down this, you know, Manhattan Street. Where do you think he's headed?
Exactly.
place, right? So, you know, and at first it was like, come on, I got the pictures. And I, you know what I did? I just couldn't. I couldn't shake it. I blew my friends off. And I went with the rat. I said, I got to know where this guy's going. I'm thinking, he's going to go all the way down to the McDonald's and everything. Sure enough, so I hung with this rat. And up ahead in New York City, I won't go here, but we put our trash out like that. It's just too difficult to get rid of it in cans. It's not going to work. It's a conundrum for us. But anyway, New York City has to put the trash in. By morning, it's usually all picked up. Not all of it, but usually. Right? So I jumped ahead and everything, and here comes our buddy. There he is. Right? What they do is they jump up onto the bags. If you're watching, they will circle around these tops where the odors are escaping. And someone needs to do a PhD on this, but you know, I put together a quick template is to test this. This research has shown they do select for nutritional balance in their foods in general. So I think what these animals do, they select like, oh, I had chicken last night, maybe lobster tonight. I don't know, but you have to have a high. But I watch them circle, then they drop down usually into a tight space, they gnaw in, and the bags become these feeding stations for them. You know, but this is sophisticated stuff, and if you read up on the research associated feeding selection behaviors with this animal, it is not just willy-nilly random unless there's no other choices. Taking my camera, a lot of times I'm always dropping my camera on a rope or someplace, wherever I go, and I hear scratching and noises over there, you know, and sure enough, I click away and pull it back up and see what I have. But they're an animal that can squeeze into very tight spaces. I think all of us in this room know, when we pest-proof our facilities, we're always trying to get them down to roughly 12 millimeters or roughly a half an inch. Because as long as that skull can get through, which on the rat is about 12 millimeters, the rest of the body follows. With the mouse, it's only 6, right? So they get the job done. Amazingly, and this is the Civic Center where Law and Order is always filmed. For example, we have rats right underneath these bushes. Right under these bushes. And at night, all they do is they visit each can. Now, the fascinating thing about being clever is you won't even see them. They'll disappear below the can. There's a plastic liner there. They gnaw a hole through the bottom, and they come in and they enter through the bottom going up. That's how they do it. Instead of trying to climb up and go in. They don't do it that way. Their ways is to remain clever and undetected. See our buddy here? So again, just this is the car, sitting in the car. The lookout, you know, trying to think about something else. The rat's coming at us, like smelling around. Is headed for this? He's going to feed on dogs, go back. The sewers are loaded with rats in the city and many cities around the world. There's the denizens of the sewers. Right, so there he is, just a little bit closer up. And if there's too much disturbance there, they'll go back down and try it at a different time. So, of course, they're specialists in avoiding our detection. Rats and mice love our suspended ceiling. And I would say, and I always say this to pest control professionals, when they have tough problems with rodents and getting control, they'll say, well, we put out baits, we put out traps, we tried this glue board, so forth. And I always say, well, tell me about your ceiling program. Because if you don't have a ceiling program when it comes to rodent pest management for the commensal rodents, you don't have a program. Right? And so these animals are up there. This is their conduits. These travel these lines. All of these lines have rat activity on them. And I was in a very famous department store, I won't mention any names, New York City in Midtown, and they called it in because rats fell out of the ceiling into a lingerie area. All places, lingerie. You know, there were screaming people trying to get out of the store and bumping into each other and what have you and stuff. And when I went back there that night, I could stand there right above the lingerie area. I could hear back and forth. Why would they be in lingerie? It was Valentine's Day. And the department store put out a lot of chocolates. I guess it was the Valentine's lingerie chocolate romance recipe, whatever it is. And so the rats, once they found the chocolate box a couple days ago, they liked the guy with chocolates. They were like, this is cool, Valentine's Day is good. So they all got up to the ceilings and waited for everyone to stop shopping. They ripped the chocolate apart. So so they're real thick up there. They're diabolically clever in some areas that when they do approach something new, this rat does not know per se it's a trap, but it wasn't there yesterday. And I took these photographs and went through a whole, notice how high alert all the hairs are and everything. This animal's on major high alert. You know, and so I went up into ceilings and put out these traps of things. In fact, I go up to the ceiling, put out a trap, come back. You know, the person I was with said, "Bobby, you missed. You missed big time. And the rat left you a message." I have PhD rodents. I'm like, this isn't fair. You can't do this. You're embarrassing me in front of my friends and family. So this is what I came up with. I'll give this a shot. Pick up the pieces. All right, so what does this word mean, thigmophilic? What does that mean?
They like touch.
Touch loving. That's right. They like touch. So thigmo being touch. Philia being a love of, whether it's books, a stereo, you know, this kind of thing, but highly touch animals. Some of the best research come out in the past couple of years, you know, is out of, you know, North Carolina and, Boston, with Moore and Ritt, sensory capabilities of rodent vibrissae, published in Neuron a couple of years ago. But basically, what these researchers showed is the capabilities of these hairs I talked about, these vibrissae, being able to detect their world and process it very quickly. And in fact, it's, you can download the video of their research, but this is the business end of rodents for getting information. And what these guys did at 3,200 frames per second is actually record how the rodents use these vibrissae on both sides of their muscles and then process that information. Right, and so it was named after the researchers, the Ritt High Speed Video System out of MIT. Check this out, 3,200 frames per second. So if you're trying to stop a whisker that you can't even see, this system does it. Moreover, it's the software where they analyze it frame by frame. So it's been one of the most incredible breakthroughs in basic research for these animals and understanding how they work and what they get the job done. And it's worth noting, here's a quote from their work. "For rodents, the whiskers on Mercedes-Benz of performance sensory pathways, they can detect things with those whiskers that we cannot even see." Right, so this whole world out there that's going on with these animals that is just pretty incredible. Now, the amazing part of this, everybody, is here we have the sophisticated animals, sophisticated systems, and yet, you know, we look at them, and I took these pictures of, this is an ordinary house mouse coming into one of my bait boxes, and I said, look at how the vibrissae extend all the way out from the muzzle, and when I was taking these pictures, you could barely see these whiskers at all. They're all moving, gathering information. So I had to take lots of frames and stop down the speed and all kinds of things. But this mouse coming into a base station, that is not a simple behavioral event. Unless it's being chased, it jumps in, this kind of thing. But there's complexities going on here. There's all kinds of selections going on. There's processing of information. Now, second to this is the sense of smell, which is incredible on these animals. They can smell. Jane Hurst out of England, out of Oxford, showed that if this mouse is coming in, it was a mouse previous to this, urinated here, which they typically do, the urine can have 5 pieces of information in it for that mouse smelling it. It can tell sex, it can tell male, female, it can tell dominance, it can tell sickness or health, it can tell species, all by smelling each other's urine with their nose as they enter holes, or not. Depending on who went into this bait box first, whether it be rats or mice, for example, this animal may smell this and say, I'm not going in there, because there's a dominant animal before me, and if I go in, I could literally be killed or attacked and hurt. And so they use their sense of touch, they use their sense of smell, and this business of all mice are curious, they go into any hole they encounter, is simply not true. So a lot of factors involved in this. Yet, if you go out and you look at how pest control is done, especially in cities, and especially sometimes by contract PMPs, pest management professionals, we'll see that sometimes the entire program is based on someone going around a room putting out sticky traps. Right? As if, you know, in New York someone said, yeah, but we use the good ones, they have bananas on them. My bananas. Is there any research to show rodents respond to the essential oils of banana? There's not, of course, but they're like, well, it's the one that was tasty banana, so it's easy to say, easy to remember, visual, and so our human terms are like, that's the blue board we're going to use, you know, the ones that have good stickiness. But rodents, very often, especially for those of you who've done this, come back, you check glue traps, often you will find patches of hair, feces, what have you, of rodents that escaped and got away. But yeah, because they're cheap, they're inexpensive, they're easy to put out, they're quick to put out. Someone can put out 28 of these around a room, and the lay public will say, wow, you did the whole room for us. That's fantastic. That's terrific. And such a good price, too. And the pest control person say, and while I'm gone, here's, don't tell my boss, but here's 6 for free. That if you need to put them out, go right ahead. And so the customer thinks, wow, I'm getting this value added and getting free glue traps or anything. But, and research has shown this, this is one of the least effective ways to do serious rodent IPM. Do they have their place as a tool? Yes, of course. Monitoring for IPM to see if maybe certain flies or roaches show up, absolutely. But for serious rodent control, now that we know the research end and vibrissae and how they use them, and that the rodent can detect these glues long before they step on them, that's everything. And so just so we know that, you know, this business of just putting out glue traps is not great. Well, more and more research is piling, as I mentioned, with pheromones and vocalizations even. One of the things I do in New York is I drop a special microphone down into burrows in alleys and below sidewalks. I just leave it there for hours, and I'm recording for the past 2 years all the sounds I pick up on my microphone. I can't pick up the ultrasonics. I'm not doing that part, but I'm picking up the sonic vocalizations. It's like whale song. We didn't know what whale song was all about, so we collected a whole bunch of it, and now we know the different nuances of whale song. What I hear on the rodent vocalizations on my tapes is I hear repeating patterns at different times in different areas, different squeaks that are repeating. And I have to get the noise experts, if you will, and the vocalization experts, the whole science just here, that I'm not qualified even going near. But the animal people in the vocalizations are like, well, here's some things to consider. So, but they do use those in different areas. The pheromones, even on corners, for example, rodents, they will mark both sides of an outside corner with these pheromones, because as they come around, this is a blind spot. They don't know what's on the other side. And coming this way, they don't know what's there. But by marking these, they can at least say, you know, I've been here before, there's my scent being drifted in the wind as it approaches. And so they can at least know that corner I've been through, I negotiated it successfully, and I can turn it. Of course, in the ceilings, you're up in the ceiling with me here right now, all of this is droppings, but it's also communication. All these trails get traveled over and over and over again. All these conduits are the ladders that enable rodents to go floor for floor, and it all gets marked up. In fact, for those of you involved in pest management or evaluating pest management services, one of the things that I notice quite a bit that technicians make mistakes on is droppings should be the roadmaps to where devices are placed. But often they're placed around rooms and buildings at every 15 to 20 feet or every 30 feet or what have you, just as a spatial thing, when in fact these should dictate, if there are droppings, where the equipment's placed, not spacing. Spacing is almost this old myth of put out something every 15 feet and that's good for rodents because they follow walls. That's all myth, and it's not based on any science. It's just because people say, well, I don't see well, they must stay along the walls. Right? But actually, any droppings is the key to where work should be done. They're the GPS for where you should put a trap or a bait. Well, then we have, of course, we don't have a dropping, perhaps, and maybe a rat may not even leave a dropping. Norway rats are famous, for example, traveling areas and collecting their droppings and either consuming them or not putting them out at all. But they definitely urinate on a regular basis. So in warehouses and distribution centers and commissaries with storage areas in the back and this kind of thing, you may want to know what has been contaminated, not with feces, but with urine. And that's where the black lights can really help us with contamination. Because there are disease organisms that can survive and do survive within the urine of rodents. And so food safety for, of course, the armed forces and everybody is critical. I think all of us can relate that you definitely don't want to be, you know, picking up or somebody picking up a can of soda or something when that's on the front end of that soda can. Okay, so it's the kind of thing where they're urinating, it does fluoresce. This is important. I just want to, a new piece of research just published in the last couple of years changed a lot of thinking for rodent control, how it should be done. This is the molecular ecology, and you can download this paper and read the whole thing if you wanted to. On you don't even need the whole title. All you need to put is home ranges, commensal ecology, Norway rats on the Google search bar will come up. But they have done some of the best research to redefine what we know about, especially the rat these days. We used to say the rat's a 50 to 100 foot range for these animals in our cities. We now know, for example, that it extends much further out. In fact, this is where the low end is close to what we thought was the high end earlier. So now we have this animal at its typical 4-inch range, 450 feet out. For armed forces and people involved in evaluating programs and contracts, and if there's a rat problem on a base or whatever have you with this species, this changes everything. Because what we found now, that the biggest mistake that commonly is made with rodent control is that home ranges are not carefully considered. In some cases, it's the other end. Sometimes you may have rats, their home range is only 25 feet no further because their nest and their food coincide in a very short distance. So this whole business of how far do they travel is case by case. We now know within urban areas it's much further. Of course, you know, I'm going back on a train later on this afternoon. You know, my office is right down here, right? And right by the World Trade Center, and the Twin Towers used to be here and everything. And right here we know the rodents will travel these neighborhoods up and down the streets. I watch them sometimes. They go for blocks. You know, I put this in only because I took a map of Manhattan, I turned it on its side. It looks like a rat. And this is in part also, it was like just coincidence that we happen to be the number one metropolis in the world. But it's like this perfect fit. And rats love water. In fact, they came over, the rat's not from, you probably know, Norway rat's not from Norway, and it's not from the United States. And I travel, people, I ask people, where do you think the rat came from? And people always say, New York City. You know, it's like, where do the roads come from? New York City. But we received the Norway rat from, anybody know where? Where's the home, if we had the home birth for the Norway rat, what country? It is China. All right, technically Mongolia area region. The house mouse is the India area, as best as we know. But we received them in early trading in Manhattan, probably from England. It's all hype conjecture right now. No one really knows for sure. But we do know there were thousands of ships showing up every week and surrounding this entire island with deliveries all throughout the 1700s and 1800s. So it's anybody's guess. And the Chinese were, in fact, we know now, exploring these shores much, much earlier than anyone realized, as far back as 1,000 years before Columbus Day and so forth. So it's, well, we may never know, but we'll see. But anyway, they were here early on. Remember this? It's still, to this day, one of the biggest YouTube hits. Rats Gone Wild, it was on YouTube, it made a big splash, it was all over the news, it was on TV shows, everybody ran with this thing. I was on the road after doing a food inspection, and someone called me up, newspaper reporter, and they were like, hello, Dr. Corrigan, did you know the rats have gone wild in New York? I'm like, really, they've gone wild? I'm like, what have they been doing up to this? You know, like, very polite, very social, you know, like, I want to tease, perhaps, I don't know. But they've been there a while, but you can still YouTube this event. But sometimes you pull up, just like I showed earlier, on any given corner, you pull up at a corner, and you will see wild rats. It's not difficult. The difference is, however, and we just did an article with New York Magazine a couple days ago, when the layperson sees this outside their apartment building, this is just one family of rats, that's all we have here, right? Which to me, I'm like, okay, it's mom, dad, and the kids. That person, the layperson sees this becomes hordes. This becomes, they're all over the place. And if they see another family out foraging half a block away, then it becomes, oh my God, they're taking over the neighborhood. Right, and becomes legions and all these words of, you know, masses of rats and so forth, when it's one family. Of course, you open up your cabinet, you see this prompts a response, rightfully so. This animal's running all over this, there's urine up here, all over the top, there's urine down here, all over the top. This mouse, because I actually tracked it, if we had time, I'd show you the whole series, it stripped the whole Quaker Oats thing clean, and its whole nest was lined with this guy. Right? And it's almost like, it, and then came back and did the can, so it was like mystery lunch later on. Is what kind of soup do you have? And who knows, you have to open it up. Although you don't want to open it up. Right? So we have that. Of course, this is important, and probably some of you here, you're in public health and public safety, and you know this kind of thing for the U.S. Armed Forces. This paper, I think, is one of the best in the past couple of years of summarizing, you know, this whole business. How big of a threat are rodents and diseases? Are they major? Are they minor? Significant? Everybody debates it. In the city I work in, to some degree, they say, well, they're mostly nuisances, not a major public health threat. I personally, you know, I'm more conservative. I'm like, after reading this paper, I feel that we need to be much more vigilant on these animals. We need good surveillance programs on an ongoing basis. But often we don't allocate the monies for that until there's a disease outbreak, sadly. That where Homo sapiens reactus to some degree. Right? So anyway, this paper is a terrific read. Nierberg is publishing among the best work out there any place these days. Singleton and Clister, these are great names in rodentology, outstanding pioneers and great work. So you can download this paper right here, 50 pages, a great read. Okay? Let me just end with some very quick trends, and I'll take any question or two. I'm just going to show you the big picture here, where we are. New exclusion materials are showing up. That's really great, because if we're really about rodent IPM, the best thing is to keep clean and keep things tight. Instead of doors being left open and then trying to put out a poison or trap to compensate for the doors being open. So we have new exclusion materials showing up technology. There's a definite strong trend in the use of soft baits compared to these hard blocks and grain blocks, right? And all that's happened here, as I mentioned, is they've added vegetable oil for the most part to the hard baits. Based on a piece of research during the 60s and 70s, it showed rodents love the taste of oil. Rodents love the taste of oil, so do we. Right? But that research was left undetected and passed over for 30 years kind of thing. We have better rodent management stations, and I use this term deliberately, rodent management stations instead of bait stations. Because these bait stations are now being used for trapping stations, monitoring stations, they're using fluorescent dyes in these stations to track them, right? And so, and now we have these fluorescent markers within the bait for tracking movements. Because, you know, if you read the definition of IPM, and this is overlooked, quite frankly, in IPM it says monitoring of pest populations, not just using non-chemical. We're supposed to be monitoring. If we're really doing IPM, we should ask a gut check, what's the monitoring program for the success of this control program? Often there's no monitoring done, both in insects and in rodents. It's overlooked conveniently, right? So we have, for example, here's that excluder, and I'm not with anybody, I'm not a retainer with any company, I'm not here as a consultant to impress upon anybody, so I get nothing for showing any slide or leaving out any slide, okay? But I just know what seems to do the job. So here we have this new stainless steel mesh. There it is up close and personal. I've used this a lot on my own, just doing field research in New York City. Highly impressive material. You would expect it to be. It's all these fibers, the rodent tries to negotiate that, they're virtually going to rip their paws apart and their face apart trying to get through this material. Stainless steel with microfiber technology and all kinds of things. It's just, this is my picture into a rodent crevice where they're coming and going. I use some wildlife foam out of a pressure can. I blended it together with a sandwich, and those things, I've gone back 2 years later, nothing. No penetrations whatsoever. They sell it in carpets as well, where you can put it on landscapes around trees. This is cut for a tree. This is the same material, the landscape material. They cannot get through this. We use this in Chinatown, New York City, among some of the worst infested rat places at all. That means 40, 50 burrows in a very tiny space. We just put this down. We put bushes around it. It was the end of the story. The rats simply can't negotiate it. All right, so good breakthroughs for them. So we have the soft strike. This first strike was one of the earliest soft baits out a couple of years ago. Everybody kind of held their opinion, but again, all this is these hard baits with vegetable, and it ends up having a consistency like silly putty. And it has oils in them, and in areas where there's a lot of dumpsters and trash and so forth and so on, we have found in general, okay, because it's another PhD study needing to be done, is in general we found this has higher acceptance than the hard bait. But quantitatively, we're waiting for someone to really get out there and do a hardcore, statistical, solid, scientific paper on this, because it needs to be done. But so far, the pest control industry has weighed in a big way, even without scientific publication. Like, well, that's fine. We'll wait for the publication, but we're telling you this works. Okay, this works. Okay, and so it gets put on rods just like the other baits. It must be put on rods. If it's not put on rods, the rodents carry them right out of these stations and run with them and drop them all over the place. They're already untrained pest control professionals, or maybe I shouldn't use the word professional, pest control technicians. They're taking these and they're not bothering, and they're just throwing them in ceilings, they're throwing them behind things, they're tossing them around like little packets, which is absolutely abhorrent in pest management. It's bad, but it is what it is, a running gun service when people don't pay for it there. There's new bait stations showing up. Bell Labs is one of the leaders, but Leaf Tech has stations. You're going to see all kinds of new things. This was just announced in New Orleans two weeks ago now, but here they have their Evo Express, and it's amazing. You have a bait station with all kinds of plastic molding designs and what have you. You can use traps, you can use baits. Down below, you lift up this is like the first floor in the basement of the bait station. Believe it or not, you have this anchoring brick that can be pulled out and put back in into this kind of thing. So technology is come a long way, you guys, and it continues along those lines. The baits themselves, now fluorescent dyes are being put into them, which is outstanding, because you put out rodent baits, and then you go looking for droppings and follow-up inspections. Wherever you see fluorescent droppings, I call them glow scats, where you see the glow scats, you know where the rodents are trapping. And that's information for getting close to the nest zones. Well, I showed these earlier because I want to end up with this. Here's our friend, the rodent, the skull, that's face. I went after this rat right here that you see. It was one of those elusive rats that didn't respond to peanut butter, meat, sausage, Slim Jim. Everybody has their favorite rodent bait that they think rodents respond to, and research has shown they don't have a favorite. That's part of their success, is they're opportunists and generalists. But sure enough, after 3 weeks, we find this rat, and of all things, he's dead in the trap. Here's the trap. The bar came down. This is a dead rat. I'm taking these pictures up close. It's an American cockroach, Paraphernalia americana, in the mouth. Now, the amazing thing is, I guess, the American cockroach went to the peanut butter to feed on the peanut butter. The rat went to feed on this, went after the roach, got caught, the bar came down, and there's a... The incredible thing is, when I came right up to it, the antennae of this roach were going up and down. It was perfectly alive. Why? Because it was in that space. It was in the space, the diastema, and the diastema fit around the cockroach's body. There wasn't a single bit of injury for this cockroach. And because what I did is, after I got all my pictures taken, you get a glimpse of nature at work here, is I opened up the jaws of the trap, I opened up the jaws of the rat, the roach started to run away, and the pest control person, Bridget and I was just going to smash it. I was like, it's a cockroach. I don't want to lose my building. But I said, you know, buddy, you deserve a break. I let it go. I let it crawl away and this kind of thing. I said, disappear someplace, but you certainly deserve to live. A graduate student at the time said to me, Bobby, I think here that this animal was going, the rat was going to take the roach and dip it in the peanut butter. And I told her, I said, Kathy, if that's true, we really are up against some formidable line. So I'm going to stop here. Captain Cole suggested we just leave a couple minutes for questions, right? Are we okay with that? All right. So I'll take any questions or comments or anything from the group whatsoever.
Yes. Keep the question short and the answers reasonably short, and then we can get to it.
Okay. Yes, over here, and then I'll come over here.
We often worry about baiting inside buildings.
Yes.
Is that a large problem in your business? And is there anything that anyone's looking at to make that a smaller problem?
So baiting inside buildings is a large problem. There's some disadvantages, of course, with baiting buildings. One is they're going to die where they're going to die after leaving the bait. So you could have an odor issue there. So that's the first issue. The second issue is, if you put bait in a building, things can go wrong. These rodents can take the pieces and parts of the bait. They're like squirrels. They'll move the bait around the buildings, drop them. So you can end up with baits being, it's called translocated into different parts of the building. Those are two big disadvantages. However, sometimes it's better to, when they don't respond to traps and they do respond to bait, your question is better to have a live rodent that could transmit disease or chew on wires or to take them out at the disadvantage given about the bait. And you have to make that call on a case-by-case basis. But it is acknowledged that baits can have their downside to them. Right, so, but in some cases you're not allowed to use baits, such as food plants and some areas. In restaurants, you're allowed to use baits as long as they're secure and it can't be transported.
When you said the
drop... Speak up, we're recording.
Yes, sir. When you said the drop baits were a marker for them to go and tell if there was food or if it was safe or not, now that we're presented with this, how would you recommend we go about placing traps with regards to cleaning up droppings? Do we leave them there so that it makes it a safe place they want to come, or do we continue to clean up and then continue to bait?
So it's a great question, and it's a little bit of a conundrum. Now that we know that there's pheromones in these droppings, feeding pheromones specifically, we also know that, in general, you should keep things clean and remove any contaminants, potential contaminants. So it's not good to leave droppings laying about and justify it by saying they contain pheromones. The general rule is now is you go ahead and pick up those droppings anyway when you find them. And the reason for it is there's probably other areas and fragments that contain those pheromones that you're not going to be able to get to, you're not going to see. So the area gets marked anyway. However, in some situations where there's no issue where the droppings could contaminate anything or there's no food safety issue, and you're, especially if you're having difficulty getting them into bait stations in exterior areas and or around traps, I always see those areas with droppings from the colony to jumpstart the areas. So as long as I don't have a food safety issue, I use them. Whenever there is a food or an interior area where I have to worry about contamination, I don't. I play it safe. Yes?
Question. Right here. Quick question. As you talk about the soft gel baits, vice the hard baits, currently right now, is your professional opinion that the soft gels are probably better than the hard baits?
Well, I will say this, and this is why we need good, sound, quantitative science to address this. I will say that when we've done side-by-sides, and we just, now I think we have like 12 reps where we've done this, we have found in most cases the soft baits, when there's food competition like a dumpster and this kind of thing, outperform the hard baits in those cases. In other areas where there's no food competition and the rodents are a little bit stressed to find any food, we found they hit both of them at an equal rate. So I think the answer to that so far is when rodents have choices, the luxury of a choice, they probably go, and the researchers, this is not new, it's, the research has shown they prefer foods with oils in them, greasy, oily foods, right? And that was published 20 years ago in
the US. So they probably southern rats then?
You know, even there, I know there's a little bit of joke in there, but sometimes, you know, regional effects are important. In fact, neighborhood effects are important as to what research just showed, whatever is in mom's milk when they're suckling off mom, if it's in an area with a lot of seafood, those young coming off of those mom, they're already trained that seafood is the primary food, and you better respond to that when you put baits on traps and this kind of thing. So if, or chickens in mom's milk, or chocolate in mom's milk, those are the baits for traps and these kinds of things. So as that comment, southern or northern, that kind of thing, actually has validity in sound science.
Yes. So diabolically clever, have we figured out or is anybody working on ways to put them to work for us?
Yes, so the question is, they're diabolically clever. Has anyone figured out ways to put these animals to work for us? And the answer is yes, among the rodentia order. You know, some of the Gambian pouch rats, for example, rodents, as you guys know, have been used for sniffing out bombs and landmines in fields and this kind of thing. And their sense of smell is outstanding. And there's even some research to show that certain rats could detect the smell of early onset of certain diseases as it's sent people by smelling their, as they exhale, that they can pick up certain chemicals. So yes, they are. And by the way, ironically, we owe more thanks to this animal than any other mammal on the face of the earth, even though we detest the rodents and they're diabolical and all that, is we know more about ourselves and we've benefited from everything we do these days, from pharmaceuticals, by using it first on them. And so if you're going to thank any other mammal on this planet, dogs, cats, everybody, say thanks to them. We do owe them a big round of thanks. Okay. Yes.
A few years ago, there's a lot of talk about pathogens in some rodent feces. If is that spreading? Are pathogens getting into the rodents more commonly? I know there was a review, but is it changing?
Okay, so essentially is whether or not there seems to be an increase or decrease or remaining stable on the pathogenic organisms within the rodent feces and urine and ectoparasites and this kind of thing. It's a regional area, city by city, it's population by population. Some areas, some diseases seem to be showing up, or at least they show up now that we know how to detect from. For example, Bartonella. A lot of papers just within the past five years published in referee journals are showing association, a much stronger association with the Bartonella group and the rodents and their ectoparasites. So it's hard to say was an increase, decrease, because we never had great baseline data to begin with. So it's a matter of monitoring it now, and that's where that Mierberg paper is one of the best to bring up to speed on that.
One more.
Is there any new dehydrating agent so that they get thirsty and go away in search of water?
Okay, so is there any bait now that when they feed on the bait causes them to get thirsty or dehydrate and go search for water? The answer is no. And none of the early baits even. There's a myth out there that the early baits cause them to get thirsty, leave the buildings, and die elsewhere. How convenient that was. It's like you don't have to go back and collect them. So, they simply would die in wool voids and cavities, but there's no dehydrating agent that, at least that I know of. Somebody's working on it, I'm not aware of it. So, but there is promise with a fertility aspect in the future that we are looking at and has great validity, and some really great endocrinologists are working on this around the world looking at finally maybe birth control for rats that has some promise. That'd be cool, right? Birth control for rats. So, but anyway, so, thank you. Thank you very much.
Come on out here. Seems kind of